Every time I'm around, I'm so excited to see your faces. So when daughter Barbara said guest minister, I smile because I don't see myself as a guest here.
Amen.
I don't see myself as a guest here. Solid Rock. When I mentioned brethren, Pastor told me before today, he said it's now Solid Rock. And it's good. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
I bring greetings from our district in Nigeria, for districts comprising of 59 churches. And greetings from my husband who will be coming in tomorrow with Samuel, my son. We were here together last year. And from Tolu, Tolu's heart is always here. She promised she will be here this time next year.
Yeah.
If Jesus Christ tarries.
Yeah.
And I'm trusting that by this time next Sunday, Victoria too should be in this church.
Yeah.
She'll be here with us. I particularly want to say that the friendship extended to me and my family by first and foremost Pastor Basil and Mommy Abigail and the entire church is appreciated. That is why anytime I'm here, you know, the family in Orange Mill, where Victoria lives, is a dear family to me. They're members of the Redeemed Christian Church. But each time I come, I tell them and I remind Victoria, I said, you are Foursquare. You are Foursquare. So anywhere my children are over the world, anywhere, I remind them, I give back to you in Foursquare. You are Foursquare. And before, either you belong to the Winners Chapel, or you belong to the Redeemed Christian Church, or you belong to the Deeper Life Ministry, and I started mentioning the various ministries that we have in Nigeria. Say one thing that is certain. Every one of you will end in the Foursquare city.
Amen.
Yeah. Revelation 21:16. I said, the city to which we all go is Foursquare. He said the city lied Foursquare. And he just got carried away. He forgot he was standing. He just said, oh yeah! And every time he sees me, he said, we are getting sent for the Foursquare city. I said, yes. So I'm glad I'm Foursquare. I'm excited to be there. I feel at home every time I find myself in the midst of the brethren and the Foursquare organization, Foursquare movement. The privilege to stand before God's people today, Pastor, certainly I appreciate and I thank you. And I also thank the leadership, apart from a pastor, the leadership of this church, that every time I come, I am privileged to stand before you. The topic to which the Lord is leading us this morning, in my heart happened to be a topic that seems the matter, the issue that is the crux of the matter, seems to be something that doesn't leave my mind every time. And why, I've asked the question why, and I discovered that if the devil or the systems of this world want to take us out of the path to which the Lord has led us and is leading us, this matter happened to be the strongest target that the enemy could use. And I feel that as people of God, as children of the living God, this is a key matter that I pray that the Lord will help us not only to understand, but to live out all the days of our life. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you for who you are to us. Thank you for your love. We thank you for your care. We thank you for your sustaining grace upon us. And this moment, like Mary did, Lord Jesus, you said at a time when you visited Bethany, the home of Lazarus, your friend, that Mary and Martha were at home. While mother was encumbered with how to take care of you, how to provide something for your nourishment and make you feel comfortable, the Bible said Mary sat at your feet, and your conclusion was that it is the better part of the relationship with you that she have chosen. And while some people went back from you, and you asked the disciples, why are you still here? Won't you go back? And Peter answered, said, to whom shall we go? For only you have the word of life. And so as we listen to you speak to us today, in clear and distinct terms, please, Lord, grant us revelation. Grant us the understanding of that which you are saying, and give us the grace to apply as appropriate. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Our scripture is taken from 1 John chapter 1, verse 1. 1 John, the epistle of John the Beloved, the first chapter and the first verse. And we will also be reading 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19 to 21. If I can have that on the screen, I'll be excited, because I desire we read the amplified version of 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. However, for the first reading, 1 John chapter 1, verses 1. 1 John chapter 1, verses 1. And it says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. Again, if I can have 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19 to 21, the amplified on the screen, I will be excited. 2 Peter, I have the King James with me. Chapter 1, verses 19 to 21. All right. And it says, and we have the prophetic word made firmer still. You will do well to pay close attention to it as to a lamp shining in a dismal, squalid and dark place until the day breaks through the gloom and the morning star rises or comes into being in your heart. Verse 20 and 21. Yet first, you must understand this, that no prophecy of scripture is a matter of any personal or private or special interpretation, loosening, solving. For no prophecy ever originated because of some man will it to do so, or it never came by human impulse, but men spoke from God. That is the emphasis. But men spoke from God, who were born along, who were moved along, and impelled by the Holy Spirit. And so this morning we want to talk about the infallible word of God.
Amen.
The infallible word of God. The Bible, I believe all of us have a Bible with us. Amen. Do you have yours with you? Permit me to ask you to wave it. No one of us is permitted to come to the church without having our Bibles with us. Amen. So if you didn't bring yours today, remember to bring it this Sunday. The Bible is God's word to us. It is our highest authority. The Bible is not only the foundation of our faith, but also the activator of our faith. Romans chapter 10 verse 17 says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing the word of God. So that matter of repeating, faith coming by hearing and hearing, is the purpose of emphasis. From that scripture in Romans chapter 10 verse 17, we came to know that it is the word of God that activates our faith.
Amen.
That means without the word of God, there is no faith,
Amen.
So to say.
Amen.
In John chapter 1 verse 14, we were told who the word is. John chapter 1 verse 1 says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. And he went further to say in the very 14th verse, it says, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So we understand that the word is the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And in that same gospel according to St. John, chapter 5, verse 39, Jesus taught that we should do what? We should search the scriptures, because the scriptures testify of who he is. So, the sole object of our source of knowing who God is, who Christ is given to us in the Word. The Bible is the only source where we can know who God is and how his relationship to humanity, of which we are all part of. His plans for humanity, his desire for mankind, how he wants mankind to relate with him, they are all expressed in the Bible. And so, the doctrine of infallibility of the Word of God is based on the understanding of God's perfection, of who God is. And we want to quickly look at this topic, the infallible Word of God, from this perspective. The psalmist in Psalm 12 verse 6 says, the Word of God is perfect. And if the Word of God is perfect, that means he who owns the world is also perfect. So let's quickly look at some definitions and make some descriptions of terms concerning this topic, the infallible Word of God. The word infallible means incapable of making any mistake.
Amen.
It said the infallible Word of God. And so when we are referring to the Word of God as being infallible, we are saying the Word of God is incapable of error, of making any mistake, of being wrong. It is incapable of failing. When we say the Word of God is infallible, we are saying that the Word of God is effective.
Amen.
We are saying the Word of God is active.
Amen.
It works. It stands. The infallibility of the Word of God therefore means that God's Word is incapable of failing or being wrong. That the Word of God cannot be wrong.
Amen.
That the Word of God cannot fail.
Amen.
That the Word of God is always true.
Amen.
That the Word of God stands.
Amen.
And in the Holy Bible, God's Word, that is written by approximately 40 people over a span of 1,600 years. 600. 1,000, 1,600, like you say here. And we know we are human beings. And we know because we are human beings, it is possible to make mistakes and err. And if we all say that the Bible was written by about 40 human authors, supervised according to the scripture, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God, Holy men did not write because they had the will of man to write, but the Bible said they were moved.
Amen.
By the Holy Spirit. Can we say, what assurance do we have to say that this word to which anchors our faith, our walk with the Lord, cannot be wrong, cannot be faulted?
Amen.
Let me say this. Our understanding of the Bible and how we view our perception of the Bible, of what the Word of God is, determines how far we can go with God. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. No man, that's why I like Foursquare. In we all know in Africa, in Nigeria in particular, any ministry, they will say Foursquare. As far as the Word of God is concerned, don't play with Foursquare. In fact, at the 70th birthday of Pastor Adeboye, some of you was a father, they asked him, if for any reason you are not in redeemed today, which ministry said Foursquare? Most of the ministries in Nigeria, they have their foundation in Foursquare. Believe you know that. Pastor W. Kumuyi will not fail to emphasize over and over that by the time they started ministry, they raise people, they take them to be groomed in Foursquare. Bishop Okonkwo, nobody. And why? Why is this? Because of the emphasis of the movement of the Word of God.
Amen, amen.
Yeah.
If there is anything that shakes our perception of what we believe the Word of God to be, it will shake our walk with the Lord. And we are talking about the infallible Word of God. How are we sure? What assurance do we have that the Word of God cannot be faulted? That the Word of God is true? That the Word of God is active? It can work? Permit me to ask that the only place we can also find that is in the same Word of God that is given to us. And so very quickly, I want to talk about the definite assurances of the infallible words, the Word of God, the definite assurances that we have. And I think we need to know those assurances. You know, one of the first battle every new convert fights is the assurance of salvation. Now, you can't know you are saved because it's not about feeling. Salvation is a fact. It's a mysterious but yet definite experience. But you don't feel saved. How do you know you are saved? At the moment, and when it happens instantaneously, when it just happened. So, definite assurances of the infallibility of God's word. Number one, biblical assurances. The Bible itself makes us to understand that every word contained inside it was inspired by God.
Amen.
In biblical studies, our pastor had just come back from Bible college. Maybe I should get set to go to now for my PhD. I have done my master's too, 1999, 2000, with the Assemblies of God Church in Jos. In biblical studies, The first thing that we want to get very, very, very clear is the matter of the inspiration of the Bible.
Amen.
The doctrine of inspiration is the one that gives the Bible the authority to claim as the Word of God. There are many books written by great men. Shakespeare, all those books in Africa, our own Chinua Achebe, Wole Soyinka, maybe I'll share with all these authors. But what distinguishes the Bible from every other book is this matter of inspiration. And in biblical studies, there is something you call internal evidences and external evidences. Both of them could be applied to the Bible. Internal evidences is what did the book itself says about its own author, who wrote it, from inside the book. And when you are talking about external evidences as applied to the Bible or biblical studies, you are talking about what the people say. In this time, we always refer to the early church fathers, what they said about the book. But this time, it is emphatic that internal evidences are there to show that the Bible is not, it didn't have the its origin did not start from man. It started from, it was God that chose to reveal himself.
Amen.
To show himself to humanity. And I have always said it from this same Bible, nobody can know God except whom God chooses to reveal himself to.
Amen.
He said, John 15:16, said, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. But when we look at it, that I chose God, I chose to follow God. But he didn't start with you. So the matter of the Bible in your hand did not start with you. It didn't start from the authors. It started from, you remember in Exodus chapter 3, the encounter of Moses with God? You know the first five books of the Bible were written by Moses, the Pentateuch, the Torah. But Moses didn't know who God was, so to say, until the burning bush experience. And the Bible said, he decided to say, let me see what is happening. And when God saw the opening of his heart, his desire to know, God spoke out. And that's what we saw. If you draw near to me, I will draw near to you. But God is always the prime mover. And so, the biblical assurance we have is in these two scriptures, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20 to 21, we read, said, holy men spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. There is a prime mover, a divine cause, which is God. Yes, there could be prophetic agencies, the author, the human authors. They are agents of God. But let every one of us that we have chosen, we've made up our mind on this path, this narrow path, let it sink into us that the Bible, which is the final authority on every matter of faith and morality and ethics, what is right and wrong, did not originate from any human being. And when we know that from the very beginning to the ending, started from God, we will revere, we will honor, we will hold the word of God with what it deserves. It is not the words of Paul. Those words were not the words of Jeremiah. Those words were not the words of David. They wrote as they were instructed, as they were inspired. And when you're talking about inspiration, God superintended not only the thoughts in their heart, but even how they came to put it down. He overshadowed them. He ensured that it was exactly what was in his mind that we have here. So please, it's important for us to know, because some people, particularly in Africa, where we don't know here, that they will say, is it not people that wrote the Bible? And anytime you begin to have doubt about the source upon which your faith is hanging, there will be a problem with your faith. Because the just shall live by faith. If we must be overcomers on this side of eternity in this world, the only instrument to overcome is our faith. Said this is the victory that overcome the world. Even our faith. And faith coming by hearing and hearing the word of God. So for you to know the origin of the word of God and the fact that the word of God is true any day, any time, you need to have this clear understanding so that the devil doesn't come and begin to, are you sure? Are you sure? And when they promise just pop up and you say, this is what the word of God say, which word of God? Is it not Isaiah that said it? But Isaiah said it as he was inspired or instructed or commanded by the Most High. So they were actually not the words of Isaiah, they were the very words of God. And let me be clear to say here, you know, in some part of the Bible, like this chronicle and begat, and so begat, you know, all those begat, 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 and you begin to read it, you get to say begat, begat, you get tired. Every word of God is inspired. And the Bible said in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 to 17, it said, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for instruction, for correction, for reproof, and listed all that. And the purpose is that the man of God will be thoroughly furnished. Quickly, prophetic assurance. There is an acid test of identifying a prophecy from God. And I want us to read it. Deuteronomy chapter 18. Verses 21 to 22. We are talking about the infallibility of God's word. Deuteronomy 18, verses 21 and 22. Is it on the screen? Deuteronomy 18, 21, 22. All right. And it says, and if thou say in thy heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord hath not spoken? When a prophet speaketh in the name of the Lord, if the thing follow not, nor come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord had not spoken. But the prophet has spoken it presumptuously, thou shalt not be afraid of him. What are we saying? The coming to pass of what is spoken or prophesied, either you're speaking it forth or forth. No, there are two sides of prophecy, foretelling and forthtelling. Whichever one, foretelling, talking about the future, what is happening, God is coming, and all that. But standing in the stead, we are the speaking place of God. Standing in the stead of God to speak on his behalf, we are prophets. So whatsoever we speak under the unction of the Holy Spirit, as the mind of God, as the will of God, as we speak it forth, the capacity for those things to come to pass determines if this thing came from God or not. And I stand here to tell you that the Bible that we have with us have about 2,500 prophecies. And as I speak with you, over 2,000 of them have come to pass. Over 2,000 of them. And even in our own time now, if you look at the events of the world, particular reference to the Middle East, and you read the account in Matthew chapter 24, you will know that when God speaks, you know some of the prophecies. I was taking time recently to look at the matter of the prophecies of Daniel, the prophecies of Prophet Isaiah, and I discovered that even some of the things they said Darius, Cyrus will do, the prophecies that came concerning him, they came 180 years before he was was even born. Even mentioning his name. Where will Jesus Christ be born? In Micah chapter 5 verse 2. Micah. For the sake of information, because we don't have time on our side. Do you know that between Malachi and Matthew, there is a gap of 400 years? Which is called the silent year, the dark end, the interbiblical period. And then look at the time Micah prophesied. Look at the time Zechariah prophesied. Do you know that every event about the life of Christ, how he will die, the kind, in fact, by the time the prophecy of Isaiah came concerning the method of his death, that by that time there was no, they have not invented how to die like that. The fact that the money with which Judas Iscariot, the amount he collected, and what will happen to that money to buy a field to for burial, by the time Zechariah was doing the prophecy, I'm sure the grandfather, great grandfather of Judas Iscariot had not been born. If you are a student of the Bible. And I'm glad that we need to hear this, because there are some people that think that because the Lord's coming is tarrying, that maybe he won't come again. He's coming back, oh. He's coming back again, our Lord is coming back again. He went away and promised that he's coming back again. He's coming back again, our Lord is coming back again. Oh, glory, hallelujah. He's coming back again. We are in the last days. Said in the last days, perilous times shall come. And the events listed there, people will be boastful, unthankful, lovers of themselves and all that. These are the events of our days now. And if any one of us, including me speaking, we have an ear, we should hear what the Lord, because the Lord is speaking. The Bible is the speaking place of the Lord. I want to say that most of the Messianic prophecies have come to pass, and the prophecies concerning the events of the last days, they are just right there. Matthew chapter 24, verse 4 to 7, please, I ask that you will read it. Now, let's talk about the implied assurances. In John chapter 14, verse 6, while Jesus was discussing with the disciples, you know the common scripture there, let not your heart be troubled, believe in God, believe also in me, in my Father's house, and many mansion, down. He made a statement that only a just and honest person will say. He said, if it were not so, I would have told you. Who will you tell lie to? Is somebody that you are afraid of. Jesus said unto them, John chapter 14, verse 6, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father except by me. In chapter 17, verse 3, he said, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. All through history, we know that God's word is reliable. The early church fathers of all and the fathers of all the church ages have found that the word of God is reliable, is trustworthy, is dependable. In John chapter 17, verse 17, the Lord Jesus Christ, when he was praying, John chapter 17, verse 17, he said, sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is true. In the beginning was the word. The word was with God, and the word was God. And in John chapter 16, he said, without me, you can do nothing. Chapter 5, verse 5 of that same 15. And in that John chapter 14, verse 6, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So John chapter 17, verse 17, he says, thy word is true. Please, one of the qualifying and distinguishing the word. word of God is the ability of the word of God to meet the very needs of mankind. The ability of that word to meet the very, no kind of need that the word of God cannot meet. And by reason of this, because we know Jesus is alive, his word is alive. And because the word of God is alive, you and I can testify today to what the word of God can do in our life. And so because of that, by implication, we know that the word is real. The word is true. The word is effective. The word is active. The word is living. The living word, the rhema. Let's quickly look at some distinct evidences of the infallibility of the word of God. Creation account. Creation account. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. Again, we don't have time to begin to go deep into the creation account, but we all know what happened in Genesis chapter 1, go to chapter 2. And since, if you took note of the declarations of God, God said, let there be this, God said, let there be, let this one be here, let the sun rule the day, let the moon rule the night, till today, as he said it then, so it has been. I was looking, thinking one day that we have never had that the scientists have come up to say the sky is about to fall, and the engineers started to get pillars, what do you call them, to begin to get pillars that will sustain, support the sky. Look, you know how many billions of years now that he said, let there be. Each time I fly and I look at right there, the firmament, I say, God. The mountains, for those of you that have been to Israel, Pastor, if you see the range of mountains and you see the placement of some of these mountains, you say, God is awesome. The seas, and he set boundaries for them. These are evidences to tell us that what God said is eternal. It doesn't change. And as he says something to you, hold on to it. The word of God does not fail. It's infallible. It does not have the capability to go wrong. If he has promised you, he will do it. He's not a man that he should lie. You lie because you cannot do. You lie because you are afraid. You lie because you are inadequate. Our God is the El Shaddai, the all-sufficient, self-sufficient God. When he says it, he has the capacity and the will to do. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
The story, I want us to read some scriptures very quickly, and I'm just wrapping up. The story of the widow of Zarephath. First Kings chapter 17. Let's read verse 13 to 16. The story about the widow of Zarephath, chapter 17 of 1 Kings, verse 13. And Elijah said unto her, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first, and bring it unto me, and after make thee and for thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of milk shall not wait, neither shall the cruse of oil fail, until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. Verse 15. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah. And she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to her, to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. According to the word of the Lord, which Elijah. So it was not Elijah speaking to the widow of Zarephath. Elijah was just a speaking place. He was just the voice. It was God speaking through him. The oil did not fail. The flour did not fail. According to the word of the Lord. Please, anytime you are reading your Bible, particularly our King James, when you see capital letter L-O-R-O-T, it's talking about the Father, the Almighty, Jehovah Yahweh, the God of Israel. And when you see, particularly in the Old Testament, when you see capital letter L, small letter O, small letter R and D, it's talking about the Son. There's always a distinction. Some people get confused, say, my Lord said to my Lord. Who is Lord? Who is Lord? But the writers of the Bible is distinct. Capital letter O-R-O-D is talking about the Almighty, the Father. And in our own day, the Baba.
Yes.
Said according to the words of the Baba, spoken through Elijah. So, I beg you, if the Lord says it, like the mother in John chapter 2, story of the Cana of Galilee, the wedding, he said, whatever he tells you, do. Because his words are active. They are spirit. They are life. They are effective. They are powerful.
Amen.
Let's look at the matter of the feeding of the 100. And let's look at 2 Kings quickly, chapter 4. 2 Kings quickly. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 42. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 42 to 44. And there came a man from Baal Shalisha and brought the man of God bread of the first fruit, 20 loaves of barley, and full ears of corn in the husk thereof. And he said, give unto the people that they may eat. And his servitor said, what should I set this before 100 men? And he said again, give the people that they may eat, for thus saith the Lord, capital letter L-O-R-O-D, they shall eat and shall have leave thereof. So he set it before them, and they did eat and left thereof, according to what? The word of the Lord.
Amen.
Not according to the word of the messenger.
Amen.
Or the prophet. He said, according to the word of the Lord.
Amen. That's right.
And where the word of a king is, there is what? Authority. Let's look at 2 Kings, the same 2 Kings chapter 7. That's one or two examples. Then 2 Kings chapter 7, verses, let's see. Just to tell you that there are distinct evidences of the fact that the word of God cannot go wrong. 2 Kings chapter 7, verses 1 to 3. Then Elijah said, hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus hear the Lord. Tomorrow about this time shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel in the gates of Samaria. Then the Lord on whose hand the king leaned answered the man of God and said, behold, if the Lord will make windows in heaven, he's referring to our God. If the Lord, he was making jest, he was making fun. He said, if the Lord will make windows in heaven, might this thing be? And he said, behold, thou shalt see it with thy eyes, but shalt not eat thereof. And there were 4 leprous men at the entry of the gate, and they said one to another, why sitted we here until we die? You know, the end of the story is, truly, truly, according to the word of the Lord, that man did not eat. It happened exactly as the Lord have said. Remember in the story of the centurion, who Jesus was getting out of the village and heard that, look, the child was sick. And he said, okay, let me go to your house. And said, you don't need to follow me, sir. I'm a man under authority. I have people under me. I just say something. And it happened. He did not speak the word. And the Bible said Jesus spoke it. And exactly the time he spoke, that hour, the healing took place.
Amen.
Distance does not stop. It's not a barrier to the word, the efficacy of the word of God. The only barrier to it is faith.
Amen, amen.
Said, if you believe, you will see the salvation,
amen.
The deliverance,
amen.
That healing you are looking for. And please, I believe you know, when Jesus was talking in Mark chapter 16, in Mark, he said, if you pray, believe, and we get what you pray for. It is not what you pray for that you receive. Please note, it's not what you ask. It is what you believe you will get that you get.
Amen.
There are many people praying, but there are few believers. Are you doubting me? Do you remember the story of Peter in prison? Did you remember that story? And the Bible tells the whole church, God, and they were praying, Father, please, have mercy, free him, let him not be killed. And they were praying and praying. And God hears our prayers. And instantly, he sent an angel to release him. And Peter came, the angel led him very close there, and Peter came to and knocked the door. And as he knocked the door, said, who is there? Rhoda, the slave girl, made him, went to the door. And because of her excitement, she ran back and said, it's Peter. And I said, what, Peter? Don't you know who captured Peter? Don't you know the prison to which he has been kept? Don't you know they started to say, you know what they said? And I'm talking of apostles, not you and me. They said, something is wrong with you. So even though they were praying for the release of Peter, they didn't believe it is possible. And in the church today, we have many people that are praying. But what they are praying for, they don't believe it is possible. Why? I don't understand. They pray, but they don't believe God can do it. And that's why they don't get it. Are you praying over a matter? Do you believe that God can do it? Do you know that God has the capacity to do it? Do you know that the creative power with which God created everything, including you, he has power over that creative power? He is the only one that has that power. The power with which he created everything. God had power over that power.
Amen.
There is nothing, absolutely nothing, that God cannot do. If there is nothing God cannot do, I'm not talking about God cannot lie, God can, I'm talking about that's your miracle. That you are, if God cannot do it, it's no longer God. But God is God.
Yes.
He stands apart. Nothing. If you say he's God, he's God. If you say he's not God, he's God. Your perception, who you think God is, has nothing to do with God. He stands far from his creation. And so you better, and I better believe that when he's God. your father's village, your mother's village, wherever you are from, because you belong to the camp of the Lord,
yes.
No evil
yes.
shall come near you.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus Christ. Please let me try to round up now. Let me try to round up now. Praise God. And what are the demands that this truth is putting on us? Is number one, we should try as much as we can by His grace and His grace alone to be true followers of God. There are too many hypocrites in the church. One leg in, one leg out. We must get to the point where we must make that choice. I've got my mind made up. For the word of God to be effective, to be powerful. Listen to me. The amount of the word of God inside of you determines the amount of the power of God you carry.
Yes.
Yes. The amount of the word of God inside of you. That's why we must read, we must study, we must meditate, we must memorize. Call the memorizing. Sometimes trouble comes. Your Bible may not be near you. And the word of God is the sword of the spirit. It's the sword of which you fight spiritual battle. Be ardent followers of Christ. Make up your mind. Let's read, study the word of God. Remember what Joshua 1 says? And remember the Berean Christians. I know this is Foursquare. We are studying like the study outline we have for the Sunday school. Just one class I have now. I just asked Papa, can I have a copy? I bought my copy already. The Bible talks about the Berean Christians in Acts chapter 17 or thereabout. He said they are always going back to study. Don't be Sunday school they come. Sorry, I'm speaking my own. Amen. I got carried away. Pastor Massey, you understand me? Amen. Oh, hallelujah. And I beg you, let's have absolute faith and trust in God. Because God is God. And let's learn to speak the word. Numbers chapter 14, verse 25, 28. God said, that which you speak in my